architectural principles, is that for about 200 years or so, that is between about 1400 and actually more like 1800 in actual fact, in practice, there was a period when the mathematical structure of the musical scale had been was being tampered with more and more completely. The theory informing theory is being held to more or less exactly, without modification, but in practice it was being modified and fiddled with more and more and more, until a point came, which we can locate in terms of the actual specification of the idea, but not in its actual practice, probably in the early 18th century, when what we call equal temperament was introduced, which is the kind of scale that we now play on all instruments and vocalizations. That's the scale that we have. And if you look, for example, at this thing here, when it stops, any stringed instrument, you'll see the frets on it have the thing about it, which is immediately visually accessible, right, as you can see it right off, is that they have an equal relation one to another. That is that the relationship of that length, say, to the whole length of the string is the same as the ratio of that length there to the whole of the ratio of the string. Actually, if you do it the other way around, the ratio happens to be the 12th root of 2 to 1. Now, what that gives you is absolutely no perfect consonance at all, except one, which is the octave. Everything else is out a bit. And by modifying this, the old Pythagorean structure, and in fact destroying it effectively from a mathematical point of view, it made it possible to produce music of ever more complexity of the relations between the notes that could be played together, because they all had this basic relation one to another. It equalized everything within the scheme. So that was the ultimate resolution of that perplexity. What I was trying to point out last week, the practice was running way ahead in some ways, very considerably ahead, of theory in what it was actually doing, and what it was kind of, as it were, kind of blindly pushing towards. Okay, now for this week. What I'd like to talk about this week is abstraction, which is a subject which it's formal in the sense that although it isn't like, say, centrality, it isn't a formal thing in itself, it is a way of dealing with forms, and it's one that's obviously had a good run for its money during the 20th century, although at the moment it might seem to be somewhat out of favor. Nevertheless, whether it's out of favor as a kind of banner principle or not, it's still effective in many ways, as I hope to suggest through what I'm looking at today. But basically, we'll be looking at material that's produced in the 1920s, in that period of the modern movement, where the first flush of abstraction was being developed. There was another, of course, after the Second World War, with the development of abstract expressionism in America, which is a related but somewhat different story. And we'll touch on that, but briefly. Now, the first thing I just want to point out is this. We're talking about a kind of similitude, some kind of connectivity potential, not demonstrated yet, between painting, architecture, and mathematics here. I mean, the principle is actually invoked in all three of those practices, and there's abstraction in mathematics, and there's abstraction in painting, and to a lesser extent, but I think a fairly definite extent, there's abstraction in architecture as well. So what I'd like to do really is in the first place, just illustrate the point at which that the first attempt was made to sew these things together as three three things which had the same basic structure and which could be identified with one another or compared with one another across the normal subject boundaries, because after all, culture was the unifier. 20th century culture was the unifier that gave coherence to these three different practices of abstraction. And really, it's Siegfried Gideon who puts that forward most clearly. I mean, not necessarily most felicitously, but most clearly. In 1939, which is when the first edition of Space, Time, and Architecture was published, in the middle of that book, there's this comparison, very well-known comparison, between Picasso's La Lucienne, painting done in 1909, characteristic of that period of cubism, synthetic cubism, and on the opposite page, a full-page spread of the workshop wing of the Bauhaus, and the first thing, comparing the painting with the workshop wing, was that they use very, very similar means, and that the abstract painting, which isn't actually abstract, but is moving towards abstraction, is using planar elements and a principle of transparency, and that this is equally apparent in the workshop wing of the Bauhaus. Therefore, that from a purely formal analysis, there is this similarity between the operations in both arts, and that moreover, in a rather more extended analogy, Gideon then connects both of these to what's happening in physics and mathematics in a way which I won't go into, but which is extremely dubious. But nevertheless, the idea is that they share a common structure, all these things, because they are, after all, part of this this immensely powerful new culture of the 20th century. Now, the thing that I think was an animating force, not behind Picasso's La Lucienne, but behind this, is a series of projects which really have a key place in the development of 20th century architecture, which are very frequently referred to. The counter compositions and house projects of Theo van Doesburg that were produced from the years 1922 until 1925, and in 1923. This is wrong. This is also from Space, Time, and Architecture. He was developing what we can see now as really a key theme of these floating transparent planes in 20th century architecture, particularly like Gideon. And it's really about this. It's on that that I want to sort of string the narrative around this morning. Actually, rather confusing structure of this whole operation. But I'd like to read to you first a statement by Casimir Malevich, talking about, referring back to the way that he was developing his own work, and this idea of abstraction, because it seems to me that Malevich, who was a fairly articulate man, he brings to the fore some aspects of this which are not always that clearly enunciated. Here we are. The ascent to the heights of non-objective art is arduous and painful, but it's nevertheless rewarding. The familiar recedes ever further and further into the background. The contours of the objective world fade more and more, and so it goes, step by step, until finally the world, everything we loved and by which we had lived, becomes lost to sight. No more likeness of reality, inverted commas, no idealistic images, nothing but a desert. But this desert is filled with the spirit of non-objective sensation. I mean, excuse these rather hand-vaunted and apparently meaningless terms at this point. The spirit of non-objective sensation, which pervades everything. Even I was gripped by a kind of timidity bordering on fear when it came to leaving the world of will and idea. I mean, don't worry about that. In which I had lived and worked, and in the reality of which I had believed. But a blissful sense of liberating non-objectivity drew me forth into the desert, where nothing is real except feeling, and so feeling became the substance of my life. That is a passage which I'd like to refer back to a couple of times as we go through what we're looking at there, but it stands as a kind of a prologue. The incidents he's referring to, incidentally, this point where he achieves this desert-like structure to his work is when he paints the white on black, the black square on a white ground in 1914. This isn't it, but it's a rather similar supremacist painting from slightly later. Too often, in fact. Now, the first part of that statement, I'd just like you to look at something here, and let's see what's happening. This is a series of rather didactic little drawings, which are done by Doesburg, Wilhelm Doesburg, in 1917. At least they appear to be very didactic in the way that they're now hung at the Museum of Modern Art. It's a painting which is called, eventually, The Cow. But what it illustrates is a procedure, which I don't think we find particularly extraordinary or exceptional in itself, which is that you start off with something that looks fairly like a cow in a field, and which is, if not sort of drawn from actual experience, at least remembered from actual experience. And this is that image there. Now, the process of abstraction, this process which we're so familiar with and which we can identify in throughout 20th century art in many different manifestations, but always taking the same route, the route that's outlined there by Malevich, is that you start with something like that, and then, well, what do? You start to try and, as it were, discover something which is essential to this, to the constitution of this natural object. And you do that by a process of abstraction. So here we have less of the cow and more of the essence, and likewise in these versions here, which might not be kind of, they might not be kind of all going in the same direction, they might kind of drift here and there, but the general sense is always away from the pictorial, illustrative image of the thing to something apparently far more essential. And we can look here, just in this series of illustrations, which are rather similar, although not quite so linear in the way that they're shown. And this is the final painting, which, as it happens, isn't a terribly good painting at all, and still looks remarkably like a cow. But as a didactic illustration of a notion, I think this is quite interesting. It's quite interesting because, well, in the first place, isn't this exactly the procedure that occurs everywhere throughout 20th century painting? You look at Mondrian, and there's, of course, a colleague of Doesburg's. And you see this, again, step-by-step procedure. Every time a painting is done, maybe it moves almost infinitesimally towards this more abstract representation. Mondrian starts off as a fairly traditional Dutch landscape painter at the end of the 19th century, very much influenced by the Impressionists, of course. And then moves on from that in a series of what seem incredibly labored small steps further and further away from this pictorial, perspectival, photographic, illustrative idea of mimetic representation. So that by 1912, he's doing paintings like this, which are still like Doesburg's cow, noticeably a tree, but which have divested themselves of many of the more obvious characteristics of the object in favor of something else. And now we go on, and this is 1916, where that process we can understand is moving afoot. And 1922, these aren't the best illustrative series, because if you take simply one series of a particular thing, like the tree that he's painting, or the sea, one can see that process far more vividly. These are just the things that I had to hand. So over that period of 10, 15 years, we see this divestment procedure Well, now all of this seems perfectly straightforward. This is exactly what we've learned to understand as the process whereby 20th century art got rid of its mimetic and illustrative aspect, and that it was a remarkably slow procedure. But the question that arises is really this. Think back to those drawings of Doesburgs, and the first one is constituted in as illustrative a way as it might be, but the next, and the ones underneath, start to use other elements, like for example straight lines start to take the place of curved lines and so on. Now, is this a process of abstraction that we're witnessing here? This is what the artists think of it as being. This is how it's presented time and time and again, still, in the literature of 20th century art, as a process of abstraction. But isn't it actually a process of supplementation or exchange that's actually occurring here? Things are being taken away, that's for sure. Certain aspects of how are disappearing. But in place of those, we're not just simply getting a kind of reduction. We're getting other things added as well to take the place of those things that were left, like the straight lines, the right angles, and so on. Now, the way in which this kind of painting develops, abstraction develops in the 20th century, the very, very strong impression is given, and I think it's a delusion, but it's a delusion which is also, I think, shared by the people who are doing it to a large extent, although one can see through it, I think, in statements like that of Malevich, which is that it is a getting at the essence of something. By abstracting, by taking away, we achieve the essence of the thing that we're representing. It's either some universal characteristic which it shares with everything else, or it's the peculiar and individual, unique essence of that thing. In either case, for that to be a genuine activity, there shouldn't be any supplementation. There shouldn't be any things brought from elsewhere and added. But that is what we're seeing in these things, isn't it? It's this addition of other things. Now, I think it's a very simple observation. But it also strikes me as quite interesting. When one reads, for example, what Delaunay was saying about his compositions in the period immediately following his cubist works, this is kind of 1913, I think, where he is trying, they're much more abstract than the cubist period stuff, where he's looking at cities and the life of power and things of that kind. And suddenly these things move across to, again, a non-objective kind of art. And there is a very, very strange oscillation in Delaunay's own mind about what he's doing. On the one hand, it's guided by laws and regulations. It's universal. On the other hand, it's peculiar to him. It is his art, and it is the thing that he's doing. And the way that he explains it is, again, it concentrates on the fact of having himself found something which is almost like a phantasm. It's almost like a kind of faulty vision that he's describing. He says he's gone out and he's seen things with the sunlight on them, and suddenly he saw all these things with halos around them. And so he wanted to paint things just like that, like this kind of phantom event that just occurred, and which his memory kind of reconstitutes as kind of, and probably elaborates upon. He wants then to create an art which is made out of this phantom impression and augments it and as it were arrests it in time somehow. And that is how he starts to develop these ideas of segmental and circular forms intersecting and developing out of that also theory of colour and so forth, which is where the sort of rules aspect of it came. So there's a fantastic ambiguity on the one hand between objectivity and subjectivity, uniqueness and generality, but also in this term, in terms of what one is taking away, and this strange, almost self-delusory supplementation that's occurring. Now, the other thing to note is that in all the instances that we've looked at, and I mean, we could go on to characterize, I think, all the aspects, all the most notable aspects of our collab period, these supplementary items are always of the same species. At least they're either to do with color. I mean, Kandinsky is thinking in terms of color, Doesburg and Mondrian are thinking in terms of color, Delaunay is thinking in terms of color. This is the thing that is being brought into play in these things. Now, maybe, of course, that color was there before, but the kind of colors that are being brought into play aren't those that were simply there in the picture beforehand. More notably, and I think more to the point in terms of what I have to say today, there are what we would call mathematical, geometrical elements. The straight line, the right angle, the things that are kind of putatively present in Cézanne's work, the Philebean solids, which he claims to have been trying to push into presence in these works. So we have a very, very strange thing. This abstraction, it's not what you read in the dictionary. I mean, if you look up abstraction, it says it's taking away, distilling, breaking something down, and finding it's basically a merely subtractive procedure. But two things, one of which is the very, very positive throwing in of other qualities while you're taking away others, so that as one takes away the pictorial aspect of the work, these other things are flooding in to fill the vacuum. And that's true, again, of all the people we've been talking about so far. Oh, this was just an illustration. This is a chicken. No, this is an owl, actually. One could imagine, for example, the idea of abstraction in a kind of anatomical sense, like Vesalius or like this 18th century drawing, where you simply take things away to get left with a skeleton, something which is essential. What I'm trying to suggest is that this is exactly not what's happening in 20th century painting. That is certainly not what's happening. We can still call it abstraction because we can use words the way we want to, and it's habitual by now anyway, but it's certainly not what's actually happening. I just want to point out, I wanted to have a Flaxman drawing here, but I don't have one, nor does a slide library. So this early 19th century thing I had to do instead. That even in the context of a fairly ordinary classical idea about artistic representation, something similar is already happening. That is, it's easy enough for us to imagine color being a kind of similitude and being absolutely like the thing it represents. But you can't, there's no lines in things. These lines are brought from somewhere else. So that what appears to be an abstraction procedure, you take the color out, you take the shadow out, and you're left with the linear structure of the thing, isn't at all. We've already got this subtle supplementation at work here. So it's not just a 20th century problem, or a 20th century issue, I should say. It's integral to all art, one way or another. What am I supposed to be saying here? So what then do we make of this idea that Rosalind Krauss, for example, makes the claim that in 20th century painting there is this really heroic idea of the desire to paint nothing. She puts it, and she relates that to Hegelian thoughts on art, and says that people like Mondrian, for example, were very strongly Hegelian, and you can see that in the way that they write, and it's certainly true that comparability there. It seems to me that there is a problem here. What she says is that the ambition was to paint nothing, but nothing which had some kind of content, and that the problem was always to have an art which maintained content, but which was of nothing at all. And that all these artists, the same people we've been talking about, had an absolute terror of just arriving at mere pattern or decoration. In some respects, this does account for this very, very cautious procedure, which one was, even in people like Malevich, of going stepwise, step by step, in small little increments towards something, rather than just simply saying, illustration is ludicrous, we don't want anything to do with perspective anymore, we will do another kind of art. That was clearly impossible to actually achieve in one sudden jump. I mean, we can look at what people were doing and we can say that with certainty because nobody did it. But clearly there's more afoot than just this business of it being nothing and still having a content. Anyway, how does that situation arise? How can it be of nothing and have a content? Let me go back now momentarily to this business of the constituents, the things, these supplementary items that are brought into play rather than simply being subtracted to find some essence to things. For example, if you in Mondrian, he makes at one point, I mean, one doesn't have to take this seriously as characterizing his entire productivity, but he says at one point that the vertical and the horizontal are key constituents in his work, and that the vertical represents the objective and the horizontal the subjective, I think it's like that. And here we see a very, very strange thing, because what's happening now, the way that these things tend to be used is in a very, very iconic fashion. In other words, these things that are the supplementary elements, which appear to have been excavated, but actually have been added, are being used now in a way which is very, very familiar, and which isn't so much related to classical art, although it has a presence there, as to even more remote forms of art, where things symbolize other things. They don't have to look like them or be like them, they just stand for them. And that's what's happening in this, isn't it? I mean, well, we have Malevich talking about the square in a very different kind of sense, that it becomes a symbol of non-objectivity and of a kind of strange sort of sensuousness, which is absorbed into this desert-like structure. But the way in which Nozitsky, Malevich, Doesburg, and Mondrian talk about their work, it's very much in this kind of mode. It's almost like a kind of symbolism that they are imputing to these elements that they are left with now. So that's quite interesting, I think. Now, this is out of place. What I meant to be... yeah, I mean, but all I was going to say, really, was the obvious point, that one can carve at the way this procedure was undertaken and what seems like the self-delusory aspect of it in the artists themselves. But isn't it also clear that, for example, if you look at Mondrian's the abstract works, one where he breaks through this barrier and becomes completely a question of these ideal and completely, so to say, abstract forms, but it's called geometric instead. It's at that point that he is able to start composing pictures which leave the middle out, which might seem like just a very small thing, but I don't think it is. I think that unstated, at first, idea of this drift towards the edges of the painting and away from the center is probably it's quite momentous, but it's easier to perform it in the context of some reduced schema like this than it would have been within the context of the fulsomeness, the overfall by Mondrian's lights. Illustrative art of an earlier period, and his own earlier work. It's a small point. But there is something quite interesting, I think, in this connection with Hegel, whose relation to modern art is perhaps being a little overworked at the moment, but it is, it's nevertheless, again, particularly in the De Stijl works, very much present. That is that the same kind of terminology is used by Mondrian as was used by Hegel. Now, Hegel had this idea that there was a certain kind of development of art. I mean, he put it in three periods, which were the symbolic, the classic, and the romantic. The one which is most closely associated with architecture is the first of these, the symbolic, and also it's associated with slightly earlier periods of artistic development, like, for example, ancient Egypt. Now, what the interesting thing about Hegel in this context is that Hegel, unlike the artists of the 20th century, and even more so, I mean, you can forgive the artists because they were trying to work something out, but the critical tradition that has grown up after, relating to 20th century abstraction, he was very, very clear about this supplementary character, because what he was saying was this, that art has nothing to do with nature. Quite nice, pretty sudden kind of break there. It's nothing to do with mimesis, it's nothing to do with nature at all. It's a human construction. But the miracle of all artistic production is to find something that is entirely spiritual, and this is to do with this thing called the absolute, which Hegel identifies with the spiritual and human condition, which is exemplified in sensuous form. It's something that really is originally in us as human beings, but which finds its exemplification out there in objects. That's the magic of the operation. But here we see, well, I mean, Hegel, it's like a kind of colonizing activity. It really is like a colonization. Man's mind is sort of taking over the world in some kind of quite majestic, but also really rather warlike fashion. And art is one of the exemplifications of this, philosophy and religion being another two. it's interesting that his characterization of the symbolic is the closest to what we would call abstraction. And that the kinds of things he's talking about are things like the Sphinx, which he says is the very symbol of the symbolic kind of art, because it is, as it were, it's something whose corporeality is overwhelming, just like this thing over here. It's been given human form. You can see this incredible colonizing activity of the human mind on objects in both these things. But it hasn't got to the point where you get that fantastic consonance that he says you get in classic art, where the sensuality of the object and its meaning and the spirit are all kind of completely unified, and it's a sort of seamless thing. Here we have these things referring to other things, being humanized, but not actually being the things they refer to, and that's to Hegel, a problematic and rather primitive state. But I think in a funny kind of way, the Hegelianism of Mondrian and those early operators in 20th century art is rather similar to that. It's like a kind of, almost like a recrudescence, a going back to something which has this peculiar property at first, but I don't think that'll last very long. Now, I've been portraying this in some ways rather unflattering terms in relation to painting and painters. But that isn't really my intention. My first reaction to this when I noticed that this was going on was to think that it really was just simply some kind of local form of delusion, which was peculiar to 20th century painting. but when I tried to then compare it to the mathematical idea of abstraction, and in fact, instead of finding some nice thing to say, well, look, this is like that, and here we have what the 20th century painters were, it didn't work like that. The opposite happened. What they were doing is, in fact, almost identical to what happens in mathematics, and for very, very similar reasons. It's really quite extraordinary. Abstraction, obviously, and still in terms of theory of mathematics, is a very powerful principle in mathematics, and it goes together with generalization on the one hand and formalization on the other, kind of symbolic language which is detached from reality completely. And just in the same way as these artists were trying to by using these rather arcane mathematical geometric elements, trying to dissociate their work from a nature which was all too predominant in art, from their perspective. It's exactly the same thing that happens in mathematics. There's this funny little story about the birth of mathematics being associated with some kind of primal recognition on somebody or other's part, where they recognize that three goats and three apples are unified by the concept three. Threeness is the thing that they share. They don't share much else, but they share threeness. This idea is an illustration of a kind of a process of idealization, which is central to mathematical thinking, that in order to make sense of mathematical relations within themselves, things do have to be actually detached more and more from their actual physical circumstances and idealized and made more kind of incorporeal and, on the root, more invisible. The more visual they are, the less, the more incorporeal they are, and therefore the better in terms of this process of abstraction and idealization that is undertaken in mathematics. But isn't it exactly the same problem? With this business of the threes, don't we see exactly the same thing? Somebody has to have the concept three in their mind in order to make that join between these two sets of things. It's not something that is in the sheep or in the apples. It's come from outside, just like the straight lines do on Doesburg's cap. So the same little problem exists wherever we look. It's still there in mathematical theory as well as in art. And what art seems to do in this 20th century period is to, as it were, rehearse this problematic aspect of mathematical abstraction within the context of painting in a very strange way. But that's not the whole story, of course, but it's part of it. I just wanted to point out one, seems to me, interesting development here. During the period, really from the 17th century right up until the 20th, mathematics has been concerned with this ever-increasing procedure of abstraction and detachment, so that it becomes entirely a thing in itself. More divorced from actual material substance, the better. More idealized, the less it has to do with practical events, the better. Fine. That process of divestment was being continued right through until at least the 20s and 30s in this century. But during that same period, first Poincaré was a French mathematician who was very interested in the process whereby mathematicians do their work. And then other mathematicians who were more interested in the way that mathematicians did what they did, rather than actually just simply doing mathematics, like Jacques Hadamard, for instance, were pursuing this idea that, in fact, no mathematician that has ever lived has ever thought in an abstract fashion. What they've always done is visualize something in relation to some mathematical idea or other. And there's funny little stories about, you know, these people who are going on in high abstract way, to sort of go in the corner of a blackboard, shoot a little diagram or so to sort out the process of thinking and then come and carry on the abstract and combine formalized process of mathematical reasoning, because actually you can't entirely divorce it to that extent. What's happened, in fact, over the last 30 or 40 years is that within mathematics there has been a fairly consistent, well, it's still a very hot issue, but a consistent shift back towards the visual, which is illustrated first in things like catastrophe theory, René Thom's catastrophe theory. Particularly interesting here, because what René Thom said, not everybody who was using catastrophe theory followed his line, but what René Thom himself said was that he felt that these things should be appreciated intuitively, not rationally. That is, the best way of understanding these things was just to look at them, at the surfaces, even if there are several dimensions. One had to get an intuitive understanding of those five, six-dimensional surfaces, and then one had to just understand the logic of them through that process of partial visualization. and then one understood the potential relationship that these things had with actual events, which he wasn't all that keen on pushing through, though other people have in a sense. And the same is true also as this push to this surge back towards visualization and away from entirely abstract mode of thought in the work of Mandelbrot and the work on fractals, which now takes such a large part of the popular journals on science because it's eminently visual. This is an illustration of the Mandelbrot set taken in the Scientific American. And it's the interesting thing about the... I have to explain this a little bit because of what comes next, which is where we get here, if you're painting, but architecture. Here we have, it's nice, because these are actually on that old diabolical thing itself, the Cartesian grid. And the strange thing is that there are these expressions which are made up of the square root of minus one and various other kinds of bits of mathematical expression, which have these very, very odd properties. It's just they're fairly simple, and they just look like any bit of algebra. But when they are worked out, they produce, instead of those normal things, which one associates with mathematical, well-behaved curves and all the rest of it, the kind of thing we're all totally familiar with, what you get is something which is incredibly ill-behaved by that standard, which are these strange efflorescences of a very agitated line here. Because what happens with these strange expressions is they're recursive expressions. That means you just do the same thing again and again and again to what you start off with. And when you normally do that, like for example when you multiply 2 by 2 by 2 by 2, or half by half by half by half, either the thing gets very quickly big or it gets very quickly small, and it's a very simple sort of relationship. Nothing terribly interesting in that. But what these things do instead is they oscillate. They just oscillate, and they keep oscillating. The smaller you get, the more they oscillate. And at every stage down, they just oscillate more and more between going up and going down. They'll just oscillate for a while and then zip up, and sometimes oscillate for ages and not go up at all, but go down, and so on. And they do it in this rather complex way, as you can see on that basic diagram here. And as you go in and these get bigger and bigger, we get, that's a little detail of the first one. Sorry, that's a detail of the second one. And those are successive details of that same piece, so that this thing just gets kind of sort of drawn down into more and more microscopic regions of that graph. Now, there's what we have here then is an idea which I think is still eminently formal. That is, we're still talking about the same kind of things. There's something we've left out, which is terribly important, which I hope to come back to in a few minutes. But Mandelbrot, who himself relates the idea of the fractal to the way that nature actually is, again, it's rather like the Renaton operation. It sees these things actually relate back to human affairs, nature, all those things that Malevich was so busy divorcing himself from. When Mandelbrot writes on other issues, such as architecture, he comes to the conclusion that something like this, the Garnier's opera in Paris, is an illustration of an architecture which actually subscribes to the principles that he has shown to be both natural and explicable in mathematics within fractals, which is that of scaling, which simply means that a very large thing, when you look at it in detail, the same kind of detail is apparent, the same kind of formality is apparent in the detail as in the whole thing. And you look further into it and so forth, so there's this kind of incredible richness, but both from the largest to the smallest scale, not of duplication necessarily, but of a kind of equivalence of formality throughout all these things. Now that seems to be inimical to the earlier practice of abstraction in 20th century art. First sight. This is the interior of Garnier's opera, which shows that kind of textualization of the object, which he seems to like so much, Mandelbrot. On the other hand, Eisenman, who takes up Mandelbrot's ideas of fractal scaling, disagrees with Mandelbrot and says that if one can actually operate this idea within the context of an entirely abstract architecture of the kind that Eisenman has been developing himself over the past couple of decades. And you're probably all fairly familiar with that line of argument. But what I'd like to do now is, this draws the artificial means, the discussion back to architecture. But what I'd like to do now is to outline for you two possible ways of looking at this process which was undertaken in the early 20th century, which are very different, lead to very different kind of results. The first of which I'd call basically platonic, and associate with this kind of operation here, which is that one method of abstraction, which is incredibly well known, is this. And here we're always toying with the same idea, a kind of world which is full up with all sorts of things, which already has numbers, forms, figures, concepts stuck in it by us, and us just moving the bits out of the way and saying, oh, look, the basis of the world are these concepts when we put them there in the first place. But you see, now what happens here, if you treat Alberti or Ficino, you see that they make these descriptions about the way the way one can achieve an idea of the informing essence of any work of art, say with an architecture, so that there is an idea that an architect has, and it is exemplified in a house. And the best way to understand what the architecture is of this thing is to imagine the house, but without its material constitution. And what are you left with? Well, you take away the substance, and you take away the color, and you take away all these kind of adventitious, all these local, substantial aspects of it, and you're left with the form. That's what you're left with. This is a thing that we can kind of visualize, conceptualize, independent of its actual exemplification in matter. Well, that linked in neatly with theology and all that kind of stuff, but we still find things which are, in a way, a kind of residue of that species of thinking through into the 20th century. And when Holly Nash, for example, did this famous thing of phoning through the description of this enameled work of art to the enameler, so that he'd have nothing to do with it except he ordered it on the phone. It was an idea very much like that. It was a kind of demonstration, a didactic demonstration of that kind of procedure. These kind of things can exist independent of their literal exemplification. I mean, the curious thing, insofar as that is concerned, when you look at these pieces that were done at two different scales, and the fact that they're in enamel, and that the back has slightly warped, and that one wonders actually whether it is that easy to do that, because the enamel is actually very prominent in this thing. And that slight deformation of the Euclidean, the intended Euclidean surface, is also very prominent. Rather nice, actually. But that's what shows up, at least as prominently as the pattern, which is the thing which is transmitted telephonically, which subscribes to this older principle of formal independence of substance. But there is a counter principle to that, even in works which look as if they're like that, which seems to me worth pointing out, which is this. Now, this is a Malevich, and if you look at it like that, or printed in a book, one sees it in the way one imagines it to have been conceived, which is as pure slabs of colour which have no real constitution in themselves, again, the sort of platonic reality of the object. But if you look at the actual thing, and this really struck me when I was actually looking at these things, you see that in the instance of Malevich, that he's painting in a very traditional way, but very beautifully. That surface is painted very, very beautifully. And it's, what's happening here is something else. Well, we've already had this supplementation procedure. We've had to bring in these abstract elements because we can't just be left with nothing. We've got something else to put in its place, something else that was already pretty well established and understood, almost arcane elements in themselves. But in the instances where these things are not terribly, they don't, as it were, fill up one's consciousness when looking at the thing, what one's actually presented with is also the actual substance of the thing in a way which is augmented and not reduced. Now, this is the peculiar thing. It's that augmentation that occurs in many of these works, and some painters were actually working with, and I think both Lisitsky and Malevich and Mondrian in the earlier period were working like that, is immensely interesting. It seems to be the thing that they're working against. It seems to be the thing that they're trying to get rid of, any materiality of the work. But actually, it becomes more and more prominent in the thing itself. This is Mondrian detail, one of Mondrian's pieces from 1918. And I think one could just go on showing works, and obviously, clearly, the abstract expressionism of the post-war period is an exemplification of that counter-principle. Practically all those painters seem incredibly aware of this new balance that has been struck, where the materiality of the thing is even more powerfully present because of the process of abstraction. This is a piece by Judith Windsor, where again you take these these elements, which one can kind of wax lyrical about and say that they are pure forms and this and that and the other, but in a way, what's interesting about them is their complete nullity. The fact that we're not interested in the fact that it's a cube. It's such an obvious thing in itself that the interest actually must be focused elsewhere. Well, unless one's playing some other kind of game with this, which I think can be done and has been done by people that are solid with. Likewise with the material constitution of, just go on and on, of Donald Judd's works, where he spends ages, according to Smithson, trying to find the right person who can do that galvanizing, because there's a special way of galvanizing these things, which leads to that hint of coloration, which is really what he wants. So we can look at the thing as an abstract format, but that's not really the work. Likewise, Larry Bell, untitled 1968, is a kind of composition. Now, I think here that, again, one can see this strange playoff between these three principles. One of a kind of formalizing into geometrical elements, the other of a sort of subtractive procedure, and the other of an augmentation, a potential augmentation, which isn't always exploited in those early years, of materiality. And that when you come to something like Christo's projects, these things of wrapping things up, the obliteration of the formal identity of the thing in favor of the texture and materiality of the surface is very clearly undertaken by just wrapping it up. In that kind of way, and I think there too, like with the narrative, one sees something slightly different, which is a procedure of obliteration, which we now have to add to this idea that one way of getting rid of images is to obliterate them. After all, and it's a kind of it's a special kind of procedure where, for example, if you look at photography, which is so replete with meaningful images. Normal photograph will be understood to be of something much more easily than a painting nowadays. But there is a whole branch of 20th century photography which goes towards the idea of getting rid of that meaningful aspect by a process of obliterating the legibility of the image underneath. This is a Malevich photograph which begins to do that. And I'd like to add to that just the observation that there are similar things happening in literary theory in the 20s with Russian formalism. These are people who are, well, not allied with, but contemporary with the Russian Revolution, people like Eisenman, Shlovsky, and Jakobson. And they come up with an idea of literary, the literary work, which is fundamentally at odds with traditional ideas of this. And they say that basically poetic diction, but also by extension ordinary prosaic diction, is constituted of meaning, which is the function of language, but its aesthetic aspect is in everything else about it, its rhythm, its sound, its assonance, rhyming structures, all these other things. All these things which have a kind of constitution which is working often against the meaningfulness in the work. They come up with this idea of making things strange, which I think is Shlovsky's term, which is an idea which is has many different variants in 20th century aesthetics, but in that particular instance, it's a way of getting rid of the sense in the words, and some similar kind of way of getting rid of the sense. So there's a kind of obliterative thing. The more powerful the actual ordinary understanding of something, the more powerful the technique needs to be to get rid of that. And you can see that in each of these arts successively. But in architecture, there is something very, very strange, again, to add to that, which is the new preoccupation with the idea of space as the constituent element of architecture, which seems so well adapted to the idea of abstraction, because space has nothing in it. It has no constitution. There is nothing to get rid of. So you have this thing which is ultimately abstract already. And I think that this accounts for the easy translatability between an idea which had grown up in German art theory in the 1880s and 1890s, and it's spilling into architectural ideas from the 20s onwards. because it seemed so remarkably well adapted to this procedure of ridding oneself of, the, of this dreaded idea of content. But in most respects, architecture is conceived, at least by the kind of people we're talking about, Malevich and Doesburg and so forth, as a dematerializing procedure. So we've been looking at this one aspect of abstraction, which induces a profound augmentation of the sense of the materiality, substance, luminosity of the actual thing. But it's still being interpreted in a kind of amaterial or dematerial sense in architectural ideas, at least in these key figures at least. So the virtual volumes, transparency, and desubstantialization, getting rid of heavy structures and so forth, seem to be key ideas here. Let's just go past that. Now, it's at this point that I want to come back, or I certainly could this way, to Van Doesburg and those counter-compositions of the early 20s. In one respect, it seems very clear that these things, which take what had been a two-dimensional idea and extend it, I mean, it's an illustrative drawing, but it's of a three-dimensional array, into three dimensions, using a different technique of drawing, which is the axonometric, which I might come back to later in another talk, and so on. And primary colors and so forth, and these constituent elements of the plane here. And if, again, we just actually listen to what Doesburg and Estrom were saying of what they were aiming for in their document towards a plastic architecture. It says, the new architecture is formless and yet determinate. That is, it doesn't recognize any preconceived formal framework, any mold in which it casts the functional spaces arising from practical dwelling requirements. In contrast with all previous styles, the new architectural method doesn't recognize any self-contained type, any basic form. Other context, he relates this to space-time and contemporary notions of space. But the two other things. Firstly, what Doesburg wants to get rid of is orientability. That is the distinction between left and right and up and down. So on the one hand, it's something to do with getting rid of the overwhelming emphasis that is placed on gravitational force in architecture, but also of the sort of left-right business, but also of any boundedness. He says it's a non-cubic architecture. I mean, they're all rectangular elements. And it's very interesting. He says a non-cubic architecture. What he means by that is it's unbounded. That is, a thing can kind of extend indefinitely in any of its six directions. It can just keep going. Now, one observation on this, which is a real kick in the groin, is that it's nothing to do with new space. It's a fairly good illustration of the principles of Newtonian space. Actually, that point is made by Rand Bannon. Theory and design of the first machine age, and it's particularly good because, in fact, it's exactly that orientability that was got rid of by the ideas of space that came in during that 17th century period through Galileo, Descartes, and Newton. So this idea of a non-orientable, indefinitely extendable, but always metric space, that is, that it's measurable always along these three cardinal dimensions here, is more or less just a very neat illustration of that 17th century idea, which for a 20th century artist who keeps going on about fourth dimension and modern space-time and so forth, is perhaps a little bit of a problem. But I think that's to misread the whole business. I think that, in fact, in terms of a material expression, these are absolutely remarkable. And a real tremendous breakthrough has been made by changing what is clearly a painterly principle in the counter-compositions that he's doing during that same year into these three-dimensional formations here, which have very, very different properties. But still, we're talking about things which have no real material property at all, and clearly don't want them. I mean, he wasn't terribly interested in the material constitution of the work. We'll have to rush, because I just want to get to the point of contrast here. So. Now, it seems to me that there's a considerable likeness in the way in which Corbusier and Doesburg work in that earlier period. In this sense, but they're doing something, again, which seems to be beyond the call of words very easily. In both instances, what they seem to be doing, by not paying a great deal of attention to the material constitution of the object, by conceiving it apparently in this platonic way, they're not simply seeing the form as such. What they're doing is they're pushing the material elements, so they're making them so difficult to register as material elements that they become embedded in the spatial formation of the thing. And I think if you look at the way that the Villas of Warre and Gash and so forth work, that strange indeterminacy of vision that you get between trying to sort out spatial relations in these things, that actually spatial relations and the things that are making the spatial relations seem to be so deeply embedded that you can't kind of do a little model like those model that showed the space inside Hagia Sophia, which is a lump of space. You couldn't do that with this. These things are so intersecting, so interleaved, so embedded with one another, that they become hardly distinguishable, which is an absolutely amazing achievement. And I think the same thing happens in the counter compositions as well. Rather more kind of obvious example being the Cité dans l'espace that was done by Frederick Kiesler in 1925 in Paris. To zip through this, I'm afraid, because I simply want to make this point at the end. One can compare, then, this kind of idea with its own, I think, really very important development of this ambiguity between space and surface, which is basically taking those old hackneyed ideas, which seem to be kind of platonic in origin, and kind of, you know, imagining the substance away from something and just but they're doing something very new with it. And compare that with what other architects, like Adolf Loos, for example, on the one hand, who certainly isn't doing that, and Mies van der Rohe, who is playing a more complex game yet again, who are incredibly concerned, preoccupied, with the materiality of the object. Not in quite the same sort of materiality that the artists have been looking at. More kind of luxurious and, in a way, conventionalized motion of surface, but nevertheless very prominent in the works, like, for example, in the Moraes here of Adolf Loos. It has copper-studded ceilings, marble floors, marble walls, and the physical constitution of those things is clearly meant to be read as physical. Even more pronounced is the remarkable work of Mies van der Rohe, the Barcelona Pavilion. These are the black and white photographs that we know, and it's fairly evident there that that immense concentration on the materiality of the surface. But it's nice to look at the photographs of the reconstruction. I haven't actually seen it myself yet. I'm told it looks a bit gross, but I reserve my judgment. I don't know about that. I quite like gross things anyway. But down to the use of things, this isn't onyx, what's it called? A highly decorative form of marble, which is used like veneer here with that kind of symmetrical facing of the stones cut in this particular way. I think I'm very, very conscious of this material surface. The black glass that lines the pool, the tinted glass in the travertine on the floor, all these wonderful, incredibly, perhaps over-rich materials, which are very prominent in that thing, become even more so by the fact of the abstraction. But in this instance, it's a synthesis of ideas that come from Doesburg and so forth, and this idea of materiality comes piling back into the thing in this particular building. Okay, and I'd simply point to something that seems to me eminently similar in the works of Boulez. That is that we don't have this oscillation between substance and space that we do in 20th century architecture. It's clearer in a way, because what Boulez does is he has all these things. What he's taught, he doesn't talk about substantiality of the object or anything like that. All he talks about is pure form and the absolute and ideal character of pure form. But what we've seen here, I think, is something which is like an interplay, that although that's what these artists were also talking about a lot of the time, there's the ideality of form, we're talking about a Stil, what they're actually doing is something which removes the emphasis from that and puts it back on the substantiality of the object, or plays with various other new arrangements within the constitution of space and substance in a very novel way. But it wasn't novel in the way that they were trying to say it was. But that's the indulgence we give them, but there's no point in carrying that illusion along in critical history and modernity. With something like this, it's simply the re-solidification of the object. And again, one can see that as a sort of powerful positive principle, going back to the Hegelian idea. But there's one other thing in Boulez which is very, very striking. This is a bad slide, but if you look at the detail of some of those drawings, of those enormous cenotaphs and monuments to the dead and all these things which seem to be completely divorced from actual human use, the remarkable thing is what you're left with is only things that people can actually physically use. Like, for example, the staircases and the doors that go into the body of this extraordinary phenomenon. And it's stuff like that which seems to interest Boulez a great deal. That is that, again, by this process of divestment, going back to the ideal form, on the one hand, the incredible solid materiality of the object is augmented. On the other, it makes it, by having taken everything else away, there is only the human presence imputed in terms of, you know, things like staircases and doors and windows, which only have a relation to that. It's made all the more pronounced. And that you get some very, very strange... Sorry, there's another thing there. I think I've lost the slide. I have indeed. But you get some very, very strange situations in Boulez's work, where, for example, in the Bibliothèque Nationale project, in the facade, which isn't often reproduced, not the one with the two atlas figures and the great globe and the flat wall, there was another one with two staircases going out and columns in the front. It looks much more conventional. But actually, the peculiar thing is that he's actually put this row of iron palings all the way along the front, so that you know you can't get into this thing. And it's like, again, that this pushing back into an entirely physical idea of contact and use of the building, the interaction between the people who potentially occupy it and the actual thing itself, which seems to be happening in Boulez. So it does seem to me that there is a a very interesting double thing that's happening here, both in terms of the supplementation issue, that is the new things that have to be put in order to carry on with this apparent process of subtraction, and also in terms of the things, this desert-like situation of taking things away until you're left with something which was there in the beginning, but which wasn't noticeable and is made noticeable by that process of subtraction. So there's at least two very powerful things going on in this world.